Hello, everyone, and welcome to another installment of the Voice of the Bride webinar, webinar number 50. That's a good number. It's a number for Jubilee, the number of liberty, seven sevens, seven cycles of seven, and then the 50th year is a year of Jubilee, cancellation of debts and freedom and liberty. So maybe it's God's timing. Some things might happen to release freedom and liberty. Just want to tell you again tonight before I get started how thankful we are for those of you that stream. We have a great number of people that watch this live, and it's just amazing to me that close to 1,000 people around the world will be watching right now live, and we appreciate that. Plus those that watch the archive, totally understandable that not everyone can watch it live. But I appreciate that interest in what we have, and I'm going to do our best to bring insight with understanding, as Gabriel once told Daniel. He's coming with insight and understanding. What are we to do in this hour? How do we posture ourselves? How do we position ourselves? How do we align ourselves to be most effective in probably what will be the most incredible season in modern church history, certainly, as we move closer and closer to the Lord's return, closer and closer to the harvest. We have to know that. We have to know that we're close to something significant, as we have said and others have said as well. And I just thank those of you that support us and help us to do what we do and provide these free of charge. And we can't do that without you helping us. And I just want to be quick to acknowledge how much we appreciate it. And we thank you for the emails that come in. I read them, as I've often said. And some good, solid emails come in and questions. And I've got a few here tonight that I'll try to answer. But I appreciate you giving the feedback. It kind of gives me a pulse of where things are and how things are being communicated. And I'm very pleased by what I'm hearing from you. And also one final thing, if you can, get on our mailing list. The only reason we use our mailing list is to send out notices. And we may be sending some notices out here over the next few weeks and months and just announcing webinars or what we're going to be doing. So if you're on that, at least you know. You can always go to our website. We'll have announcements there. But by being on the mailing list, you get those announcements. We never do a solicitation. I've never done one in the history of our ministry. Never done a solicitation letter. So the only reason we have the mailing list is to keep you informed. And also maybe consider subscribing to our YouTube channel. You'll get notices then when we put things up. I'm going to take advantage of this tool and this interest that we've had in people watching the webinars. And we used to do a word for the moment. Maybe we'll kind of reinitiate that little 10 or 15 minute little iconic words that people seem to appreciate. But the webinars have given me a great opportunity to sit down, share my heart, what I believe, lay it out there, unencumbered, and just really, put on the line what I believe and what the Lord has taught us. And for those of you that are in our tribe, I'm hoping it's helping you some with what we're sharing, that it would give you insight and all the things that we're hoping that come from it. I want to talk tonight about the example of Micaiah. last webinar, I began to talk about God's spokesman, our great need for a very clear prophetic word to come forward from not just one, but many ministries. And, one of the ways the Lord proves His word is by bringing it to pass. I appreciate words of knowledge. I do. I appreciate divine information. I have longed for that. I have experienced it to some degree. And I want good information. I want God to reveal secrets and hearts and names and dates and all of that. But most importantly, what comes with the prophetic is fulfillment. In other words, if we give somebody their name and where they're from and give them a word, the word never comes to pass, then we've missed the mark. My heart right now and what I tried to communicate last webinar is the need we have for words to come to pass. That was the earmark of a prophet in Israel. If they said something, it came to pass, you knew to hear him. And we've got to get to this place. A lot of things have been spoken out there, but very few things have been fulfilled. Now, some of it has been because of delay, no doubt about it. But I want to talk about that tonight a little bit. I want to kind of culminate that whole thought process. But before I go into that, I've just had something brewing in my heart, you know, for the last 3 or 4 weeks. I did a meeting with our really good friend, Barbara Yoder, excuse me, up in Michigan. And the name of her conference was Consuming Love. And that was, you know, kind of a provocative topic. I did it with a man that I really respect, Bishop Joseph Garlington. He's a man that I'm very jealous of, and I say that being funny. But this man can preach up a storm. I mean to tell you, Joseph Garlington can preach. And the first time I heard him preach, I thought, man, I've not heard preaching like that hardly ever. And then he got through preaching, and he sat down at the piano and began to play the piano eloquently. And I'm like, no way. He can preach and play the piano. Then he began to sing beautifully. I'm like, that's just not right. It's not right. Somebody can preach like that, play the piano like that, and sing like that. And then I found out later he's a scholar on top of all of that. But it was so good to be with Bishop Garlington and to hear his insights. He's got such solid teachings. I told the people if I lived in Pittsburgh, that's where I'd go, because I can't imagine there being a dull moment in that church. But while we were there, I revisited something that was kind of a fascinating story. I may have shared it once or so years ago in some meetings, but it's been several years since I shared this experience or this episode of something that happened, and it's going to take me just a minute to share it, but it's worth it, I believe. And I want to lay the context of it. But I've had Bob Jones on my heart quite a bit lately, you know, and had some people from John Paul Jackson's ministry come by yesterday, and they were on staff with John Paul, and we just, you know, we visited and had coffee and talked about John Paul, and made me think about the cloud of witnesses, and it's made me think about Bob, and just been kind of reminiscing a little bit about some of the trips that we used to take back in the 90s. Beginning in 1995, Wanda and I would drive down to Chipley, Florida, and pick up Bob and go to every Morningstar event they had. Major conferences, boot camps, anything that was of a conference gathering nature, we went. And we always drove. Bob didn't like flying, so I would drive down in a van, pick him up, and we would have a 10-hour drive one way to Charlotte. Never a dull moment. Never a dull moment. It's kind of interesting. You might be interested to know that on every trip, and there were many, I don't know how many, but 3, 4, 5 a year for like 5 or 6 years. Every single trip we took to Charlotte, when we passed through a certain county on the border of North and South Carolina, Cherokee County, South Carolina, as we passed right adjacent to Cherokee County, South Carolina, going and coming back, every instance, Bob fell into a trance. Every instance. And so we began to, you know, be accustomed to the fact that we were getting close to this one spot, whatever it was, for whatever reason. And Bob would be sitting there having a conversation. All of a sudden, his head goes back on the back of the seat, and he's in another realm. And he would be in this realm and that realm at the same time. It was a fascinating thing because we would say a person's name, and he would have a word for them. Just I was driving, and Wanda would hold the recorder or whatever, and we would just, you know, whoever came to mind, just whoever the Holy Spirit quickened to us, we would just say that person's name and he would have a word for them. We recorded it. And then we'd do it another one and just keep bringing people's names up to him that he would see in a vision. Some of it he would see symbolic things, certain things that, you know, may or may not, that may have meaning to them, but not to us. And then it would just lift. As quickly as it came, it lifted. But that happened every single time. But in 1996, we were planning to drive to Charlotte to a conference. And Bob had received a phone call from a pastor in Atlanta. Two men from South Africa were coming to speak at his church. The pastor was Mark Lawson. Some of you may know him. And one of the men's name was Paul Dell, and the other one was Elijah Mazwangani. Paul was a white man. Elijah was a black man. And they were partners in ministry. They had done a lot of things jointly together. And so they had asked if we could leave early, a day or so early, stop in Atlanta, spend a day with them before going on to Charlotte, which we did. Bob had met Paul Dell in England, and so we agreed to do it. So I picked Bob up, and we're on our way to Atlanta, and so I say, okay, what's the deal? You know, what's the deal with Paul Dell? And Elijah Maswangani, he said, well, I had not met Elijah Maswangani, but I've met Paul Dell. And so he began to tell me the story, where in 1990, he had been doing ministry with John Wimber. I think 89 and 90, they kind of consolidated some things. People that may know that history know a little bit about that. But they were holding a conference, if you'd call it that. John Wimber was hosting it. And I can't remember if it was Holy Trinity Brompton or Westminster Chapel. I can't remember. I know they did meetings in both of those places, but I can't remember if this particular one was at Holy Trinity or the other. But it doesn't really matter. They were in one of those two churches. You had Paul Keane there, Mike Bickle, and John Paul Jackson, and Bob, along with John Wimber. John Wimber was the main, kind of the host. And so we're driving up, and Bob is telling me this story of how he met Paul Dell, where they had him down in the crypt, is what they call it. Anyone knows anything about the English language, the crypt was kind of the, what we might call the basement or the sub-level of a building where they kept the caskets and things of that nature back in the day. And some of these buildings are so old, of course, you know, and so they would put him down there. He called it being in the crypt, kind of in a sarcastic way, but just being a little funny. But they put him downstairs ministering to leaders, set him in a chair, and they would bring leaders before him just hours and hours at a time. In fact, Bob and I did that at Morningstar for a couple of years. And so he had spent the day, one day, all morning long, ministering to leaders down in the crypt, and then they broke for lunch and came back and did some more after lunch, and Bob liked an afternoon nap. He liked his nap. Of course, he got a lot of revelation that way, too. But so it came time, you know, to take a break and mid-afternoon, and so what Bob didn't know was that a man by the name of Paul Dell, who was a missionary, he lived in South Africa, but he went up into these other nations like Zambia and would go to these remote villages that had no water well, and he would drill a water well in a village with the agreement that he would try to evangelize the village. That was his ministry. And he, you know, of course, would take on the witch doctor. I'm going to come back to that in just a minute, but that was an amazing tool. And if you have someone come in that can drill a well for you where you can pump water as opposed to go into the river to get it, that's a big deal. So that was his ministry, and some problems had arisen, and his finances had dried up. And so Paul is down in South Africa, and he's seeking the Lord. He said, Lord, I need an answer. I need to know why my finances have dried up. I need to know why I'm having trouble, because we're doing this at your word. And the Lord spoke to Paul Dell and said, listen, if you'll go to England to this event, I will give you an audience with Bob Jones, and he'll give you a prophetic word and tell you what's going on. So the man did that. He bought an airplane ticket, didn't know a single soul in England, flew there, and with a word from the Lord that he would have an audience with Bob Jones. That was his word. And so as the conference went along, you know, he kept trying to get up front, or, you know, and Bob was down in the crypt. So he never got in a place where he could actually have a conversation with Bob. And he was very frustrated and a little dejected, you know. And so now back to Bob taking his nap. So Bob, you know, comes back to his hotel room. He's exhausted, wants his nap. He goes to lay down. And the moment he lays down, he told me out of his own mouth, the Lord appeared to him. Now, how the Lord appeared, I don't know, but he said the Lord appeared. And the Lord said, I want you to get up out of bed, and I want you to go down to this park down there. There's a man down there by the name of Paul Dell, and I've sent him here, and I'm going to give you a word for him. And Bob's like, Lord, I need a nap. The Lord wasn't interested in his nap. And he said, get up and go down there. He said, I sent him here, and I promised him I'd give him an audience with you. While that's going on, Paul Dell is out in the park, not too far from the hotel, sitting on a bench, kind of complaining, saying, Lord, you told me if I would get an airplane ticket and fly to England, I would have an audience with Bob Jones. And here I am, I'm sitting here, I can't get within 100 yards of him, and the conference is about over, what am I going to do? So he's sitting, just imagine this, he's sitting on a bench, having that conversation with the Lord. Lord, you sent me here and told me that I would have an audience with Bob Jones. And he looks up across the park, and Bob is walking towards him. Can you imagine how faithful the Lord is to keep his prophetic words? And so Bob walks up to him, and Bob says, are you Paul Dell? And he was a little grumpy. He was even telling me when he was telling the story, we're driving up to the meeting, you know, and he said, I was a little grumpy. He said, are you Paul Dell? And he said, yeah, I'm Paul Dell. And Paul started to ask him his question. Bob said, wait just a minute before you say another word. Before you ask me one word, he said, the Lord just appeared to me in my room. He told me to come down here and meet with you. And he said, the Lord told me you raise the dead consistently. And Bob and Paul Dell looked at Bob and said, don't you? Like, isn't that just Christianity 101, Acts 10:8? And so Bob had this word for him, this powerful prophetic word, and the Lord fulfilled his promise and gave him the word that was a strategy to be able to continue to take the water wells into these villages of these remote areas of Africa and win the village. So that was kind of the preliminary conversation we had driving to Atlanta. So we get to Atlanta and we're meeting at this church, and we met for 6 hours. One of the most fascinating 6 hours I've ever spent. As I listened to these men telling these stories, and I'm going to go ahead and tell a couple of them, and it may stretch a few people, but probably we need to be stretched a little bit. But Paul Dell was kind of an evangelist, a prophetic type evangelist, you know, and Elijah Maswangani was his friend, but he was much different. He was much more, I can still remember right now thinking, I've never heard such wisdom coming out of a man's mouth as I was hearing coming out of this black man from South Africa. And then I realized now what I was discerning was he was an apostle. He was apostolic. I don't know that in 1996 that registered with me, but I recognized that he was able to take prophetic revelations that Bob and Paul were sharing and kind of encapsulate them in language that makes a whole lot of sense. And it was just a fascinating story. So they finally started telling the stories of some of the events, things that happened when they went into some of these villages. I'm going to tell you two. There were many. We were 6 hours. You can imagine how many stories there were. We have an audio cassette, several cassettes. Somewhere in my storage, I have these cassette tapes of these conversations. And I'm trying to dig them out. But I remember one in particular where, you know, Paul said that what he would do, of course, is go in. The first thing he would do without even trying to evangelize the village was just drill the water well. Once he has water flowing for the people, they're very excited. Then his next step would be to take on the witch doctor. Buying the strong man, plunder his house. And every village had a witch doctor. Every single village, some of them were men, some of them were women. And in this one particular one, I'm going to tell the story off first. It stood out to me for some reason. He went into the village and was having a little bit of a hard time, you know, getting a breakthrough on the village. And he was confronting a little girl, actually about an 18-year-old girl, he said. And because the principality of the area was operating through this girl, and he discerned it, he knew it, and so he had some people there praying, and they were in this spiritual conflict, if you will, and he said right there before his eyes, this little girl turned into a tiger. He said, I watched her facial figures contort and change, and she had the face of a tiger right there in front of me. That's when you know it's the real deal. And I know that might stretch a few people, but you know, this is the last day. So we need to realize what goes on out there. We may not have seen that in America, but we need to know what's going on. And it may yet be in America. And it may be going on in America in remote places. But we need to realize we need serious authority. I remember an experience I had when I was in Alberta, Canada, where a vision, a trance came into my room. And the Lord told me, he said, what has previously been relegated to India and Africa is coming to America, and someone had better get authority with him in a hurry. And I knew that this dealt with this incredible high-level demonic stuff because restraints have been lifted. And so he tells the story of getting the little girl delivered of the principality and winning the village. And this other one really stood out in my mind. I can remember now still just sitting there listening to him tell the story of how he had done the same, drilled a water well in a certain village. And in this particular case, the witch doctor was a man. And he said he could not get breakthrough. He was a very high-level warlock. And so He one night, you know, trying to get the breakthrough, he went into a hut. He had a couple of ladies there with him that knew how to pray. He called them blood sisters. He said, ladies that knew how to apply the blood and the blood of the Lord. And so they were sitting around a little fire in a hut praying, is what he said. Just interceding. He taught them how to pray in the Spirit, and they were praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in tongues. Just asking the Lord for the strategy, asking for the authority to break the power of this witch doctor over the village so they could win the village for the kingdom. And they said, while they're in the midst of praying, he said, a naked man came crashing through the ceiling of the hut, landed right in the middle of them. Right in the fire, he actually said, jumps up out of the fire. And it's the witch doctor. It's the witch doctor, the very man they were trying to get deliverance from. And this is what he told me. You can accept it or you cannot accept it. It's up to you. I believe it. He said the witch doctor had shapeshift into a flying object, something that flew. I don't have any doubt about that. I don't have any doubt that man was telling the truth. And as he was flying over the hut, he flew through the prayers of those people praying, and it broke his power. And he came crashing through the ceiling and landed right in the middle of them. And the Lord delivered the man, delivered the principality, and he won the village. Wow. Now listen, if you think that doesn't happen, I can tell you I saw it with my own eyes. I was in Sheffield, England, maybe 2011, 2012. I forget exactly what year. Stephen Shelley was preaching that morning, and the Lord told me to stay in my hotel room. I had preached the night before. The next morning, Steve was preaching, and I normally would never miss the service, but the Lord told me to stay in my room. And Steve went on, and I told Steve that the Lord told me to, so he went on to the session. So I had no idea what he was preaching. And while I'm laying on my bed praying, I looked down at the foot of the bed, and with my eyes, I saw a man standing there in ethereal form. He had tattoos all over him. I could see that. And he reached out as if he was going to touch me. And I rebuked him in the name of the Lord. I saw him with my eyes. And I rebuked him in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the moment I did, right in front of my eyes, he turned into a raven and flew out. That's the truth. Now, we had dealt with some things the night before. In my session, I had dealt with some things in the realm of the Spirit. And, you know, it's like Paul Dell and the witch doctor. You start dealing with things in the Spirit, you're going to have a conflict. It's going to be a conflict. And this is solemnly the truth. I said, I'm not telling anybody that. I'm not going to tell them what happened. So they pick me up for lunch, and I get in the car, and something just says, you know, maybe I should tell, you know, what happened. So I just tested the waters a little bit. I forgot to tell the most important part. I'm lying on the bed before that happened. And I heard the sound of lightning, not thunder, lightning. I heard this crackling sound like a lightning bolt crackling through the sky. And when it did, I felt this weight come on me, a heavy, good weight, a weight. And it got heavier and heavier and heavier. And I knew it was God. I knew it was the Lord. I knew it was the anointing. And it was getting so heavy. I'm lying on this bed. I'm thinking, I can't breathe. You know, it was that kind of weight. Physically, I was having a hard time breathing, and then it lifted. You know, it came for I don't know how long now. I don't want to say minutes, but you know, for a number of seconds, it was there, and then it lifted. And no sooner had it lifted than I looked to the foot of the bed, and there stood the warlock. And that's when I rebuked him. He turned into a raven and flew out. So they picked me up for lunch, and I thought, well, I'll share at least about the weightiness coming in, and so. I said, I had a strange thing happen. I heard the sound of the crackling of lightning, and the presence came into the room, and it got heavy and heavy and heavy. And I said, you know, almost like my flesh couldn't handle the weight of it. And the pastor of the church in Sheffield said, you won't believe it. Steve Shelley just preached this morning on the coming glory of God that we aren't quite ready for it. That it's going to be heavy. I mean, the very language of what happened to me, he was preaching in the meeting. And of course, I had no way of knowing that. And so we drive along, and I thought, well, that went pretty well. So maybe I should tell the other part. And I said, well, right after this weightiness presence came, I looked down the foot of the bed, and there stood a man. He had astro projected himself into my room. And I said, when I rebuked him, he turned into a raven and flew out. And the pastor said, you will not believe it. He said, Steve just got through prophesying that one of the principalities over the region operated through a warlock that was able to shapeshift into a raven. He said it's on tape, it's on record. He preached it while I was experiencing it in the room. So that happens. That was just a couple of years ago. So you can't tell me those things don't happen. They do. We need to get ready for that. If we're going to win our regions, if we're going to win our cities, we're going to have to learn how to bind the strong man. We're going to have to learn how to go into the courts of God to get some serious authority where a verdict is rendered in our behalf and we can dethrone some things. And if a spirit of murder is over a region, you know, you can try to get one person delivered or another person delivered, but as long as that spirit has jurisdiction, it's going to keep manifesting itself on all different fronts. So eventually you got to deal with what's up here, you know, have a word in your mouth and deal with the heavens, and what's in the heavens will be founded on the earth. Then say to my people, to Zion, you are my people. That's what it says in Isaiah 51, verse 16. The same thing that happens in Jeremiah chapter 1, where he says, I'm putting a word in your mouth to uproot, to tear down and destroy, but also to plant the bill. You uproot, tear down, destroy first. Once that's been dethroned, uprooted, then you plant the kingdom. But I too subscribe to the idea you don't go around throwing rocks at principalities unless God's told you to. I believe that's wisdom. We don't want to pull something down until we have something to put in its place. Because if we don't, something worse is coming back. So I believe that. I believe that's a strategy. I believe that's what we're going to have to function in. And so Paul Dell, you know, was telling the story, and he and Elijah were just, you know, for hours, and, you know, and I'm just listening. This is 20 years ago. You got to realize this 20 years ago. And I'm just mesmerized by the supernatural, and Bob's telling his stories and they're telling their stories, and just in a fascinating 6 hours. So we come to the end of the 6 hours. This is what I'm really leading up to. And we're about to break and go have dinner together. But we're still at the church. And so they wanted to pray for Wanda and I. So we sat in a chair and they laid hands on us and prayed over us and all of that, you know. And it was a powerful prayer. I need to pull the tape out again and listen to it. But I remember thinking how powerful it was. But Elijah Maswangani, the black man, said to me, I have a book for you. And I had listened to him for 6 hours. And I knew him to be a man of great wisdom. So I was pretty excited that he was going to give me one of his books. I was going to read it. I felt like there was something there for me. So we walked across where he had his products. So they were going to be sticking there at the church. So we had a big box, you know, about this size. Maybe 25 books are in it, something like that. Some of them were thick, hardback books and all the different sizes. And he stands over the box, you know, and he starts digging around. And he pulls this book aside, and he pulls that book aside, and he's looking, he's shifting things around. And finally he says, oh, here it is. And he pulls out a little pamphlet, you know, about like this, you know, about a 25-page pamphlet. And I'm like, he's got inch and a half thick books down there, hardcover, and he pulls out a little pamphlet and gives it to me. I wasn't offended, but I'm like, I was kind of curious, you know. So he said, I want you to have this. I feel like it's for you. And so I just, you know how you do. I put it in my bag and I carried it home. And the name of the book was called My Baptism of Love. And it outlined an experience this man had. You got to realize he was a black man living in South Africa where racial hatred was at its pinnacle. And I already had heard some of the stories of what he had had to endure and some of the racial conflict that they had had there. And for whatever reason, he wanted me to have that book, and I'm going to read to you. I don't normally like to read things, but I think I can read it and have more impact on you. I know I shared it in Michigan, and so if you happen to have been in the conference, this may be a repeat to you, but there are thousands of you that will be watching this that probably do not know it. His name is Elijah Maswangani. I have not seen him since 1996, know nothing about him. I have talked to a couple of people that said he's doing well, but I don't know anything else about him. But here was his experience. This is what I want to read to you. I just want to put it out there and just see what the Lord will do with it, you know, just to see what he'll do. He said, I was alone sleeping in my room after I had finished my usual devotions. All of a sudden, at about 2:00 in the morning, I heard and felt beautiful music surging within me like a symphonic orchestra at the highest crescendo. The music within me was joined by a host of angels around me. There was perfect harmony between the song within me and that of the angels that were around me. The harmony of the music, which was accompanied by instruments, was not only beautiful to the highest degree, but also absolutely perfect and completely fulfilling my deepest spiritual and emotional longings. I felt transported by the music into the heavenlies. The chorus sang was, "Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that is well known." It was as if someone was turning the volume higher and higher. And at the highest crescendo, I felt drowned in the ocean of the angelic music. At that point of sweeping ecstasy, I saw the most beautiful hand of Jesus, but I did not see His body. The hand moved gracefully towards my forehead. After His touch, I got out of bed and burst into tongues. Utterances of praise and speech and song, which were in perfect harmony with the angelic singing. My hands were stretched to the heavens from 2 o'clock to 6 o'clock in the morning. My hands and feet never got tired. Then I sobbed with joy and peace and happiness. It was at this point, here it is, this is what I'm after. It was at this point that I was baptized in love. From that moment on, I knew that I had gone through a new experience with God. When I opened the door at about 6 o'clock in the morning, I loved everything my eyes fell on. I loved the people of various races. They appeared to me to be like God's bouquet of flowers. I loved the sky, the clouds, the trees, the grass, the buildings, the cars, the animals. All my suspicions and judgmental attitudes and fears were gone. I was so full of peace, which Paul describes as one that passeth all human understanding, that for the first time in my life, he said, I felt completely free. Perhaps it is that experience that gave me a new definition of love, namely, God's love is freedom. After that glorious and supernatural experience, my life and ministry have never been the same. You think? God gave me the capacity to understand and to love people unconditionally and to forgive unconditionally. It is that love that enables me to forgive untoward situations in advance. Because of this experience, I love all people. I think people. I dream people all the time. In my travels throughout the world, people have testified about this love of God in me. I get through to most people without much effort because God made all people to respond to love. Even when people may not understand your language or your culture, they do know when you truly love them. Wow. I was very thankful when I read that pamphlet. I thought, wow, he couldn't have given me a better word. And for whatever reason, he thought that was for me. Maybe I needed it. Maybe I need a baptism of love. I'm sure I do. The Lord has dealt with me on this issue of love this year in a way that I have never experienced in my life. I'm not saying I had what he did, but I've certainly had some things going on, and I think differently than I did at the beginning of this year. It's kind of an amazing thing. And so that's why this maybe has some meaning for me this year. And I just want to release it to you. Maybe out there are people that God is ready to baptize them in love. Can you imagine being immersed in love? I remember one time I had an experience with the glory of God. It was right after my brother had died, and I was at not a low place, but I was hurt. We had prayed and fasted for a year and a half for him to be healed, and he died. And so I was a little hurt by that. And I went into this experience where this cloud appeared, and the cloud just kind of engulfed me. And I heard some of what I heard this music, and it sounded like a million instruments to me, like a million instruments all playing at the same time, coming from everywhere at the same time. In other words, you might say, was it coming from above? You know, it was coming from everywhere. It was coming from this side, that side, underneath, behind, around. It was almost like you're underwater and the water is touching you from everywhere at the same time. And that was the way the sound was coming. It was touching me all at the same time everywhere. And it lasted for a few minutes and lifted, and it certainly was impacting. And so I'm just, I'm believing maybe, and I'm hoping that some of us can have a baptism. Maybe all of the bride of Christ will have a baptism of love before this is over with. That in whatever way the Lord chooses, whether it be as it was with this brother, where the Lord sends a hand down and touches your forehead, or whether you're caught up in a cloud of glory, or whether light comes into your room, or whether you're in a dream, trance, or in prayer, in tongues, however it is, may there be an overshadowing of God's love. I think that's the secret. That's the secret. I'm not saying I'm there, but I'm certainly closer than I was a year ago to understand a little bit more about God's heart of love and the Father's love. And so anyway, I don't want to go too much into that because it would be hard to share it. But Lord, I pray that you would give us a baptism of love. Just immerse us in you. He is love. God is love. You know, God is the kingdom. Everything has to have a source. And he is the source. He doesn't have love. He is love. He doesn't have joy. He is joy. He's the source of joy. He doesn't have a kingdom. He is the kingdom. He is the source of the kingdom. And I believe he's about to make himself accessible in this generation to a body of people that have been groomed and prepared for that. And my prayer is, Lord, now is good. You know, David prayed that, Lord, how long? How long is it now good? Let now be good for these baptisms of love. I want the gifts of the Spirit, sure. I want the ministry of healing and all that. But I think maybe we can tweak our desires a little bit. I think if we can get a baptism of love, then I think some of these other things might come much, much sooner, much easier. I remember William Branham talking about the gift of healing that operated in his life and how he talked about when the Lord would come as the living word, that he could feel the people's needs. He could, his compassion was touched by their needs, whether it be for sickness to be healed or whether it be family issues or whatever, he could feel it in his bones, if you will. And he said it was in that place that the miraculous was released. The Bible says the Lord can be touched by the feeling of our infirmities. And the people would come to him when he walked the earth in human form, and his compassion would go out to the people. And the Bible said, and he healed them all because of his compassion. And I believe if we're going to walk in the level of healing, if we're going to walk in the level of deliverance, if we're going to walk in the level of power that we have been on a quest to receive, it's going to be birthed out of love and compassion. I believe that. And I believe for the bride of Christ without exception. I don't think that we'll have the fullness. Now, I'm not saying some people can have some gifts, but I'm talking about ministering. I hope people have been able to hear what I've said over the last several webinars. It's one thing to operate in a gift, and I want every gift God will give me. But it's another thing to operate in a presence. It's another thing to operate in the presence. And it's one thing to have a gift of healing, but I'd like to have the healer present. I don't just want a word of knowledge. I want a word of knowledge, but I don't want the Lord to stop with a word of knowledge. I want him to bring the Spirit of knowledge. Not just a word of wisdom, but the Spirit of wisdom. Not just a miracle, but the Spirit of might, because it's him. He is the seven spirits of God that are before the throne. And so he is the source of all of that. So if you can bring the source, everything else comes with it. That's what the bride of Christ will have. That's what the sons of the kingdom will have. They'll operate in a different dimension. And we've seen a few isolated forerunners that have done that, as you've heard me say often. That's what Mariah would with Etterhead. There was a glory realm that came in our meetings. She didn't just have a nice healing gift. She didn't just, you know, she had a realm of glory that would come and fall in the meetings. And you can read the testimonies of all that happened, the healings and deliverances and commissioning to foreign lands and trances and visions and all that went with it. And the same was true with Catherine Kuhlman, and the same was true with John G. Lake. John G. Lake was a man of great compassion. I've read every book that I have found on John G. Lake, and he says the same things about being touched. And so, Lord, give us this baptism of love, I ask, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, amen. Well, I want to kind of Well, the last few minutes we have here kind of wrap up some of what we were talking about. I said we're going to talk about Micaiah. You know, that's he's in 2 Chronicles chapter 18, if you want to turn there. You know, sometimes when there are names in the Old Testament, if I don't know how to pronounce them, I go and listen to an audio version of the Bible and listen to how they pronounce them, and that's how they pronounce his name, Micaiah. Fascinating guy. This kind of goes in line with what I talked about the last webinar, where I spoke about Korah, if you'll remember. Korah being a rebellious form of leadership. And he told Moses, listen, we got the Spirit, like you've got the Spirit. Why do you presume to be the leader of Israel? And if you remember me sharing the story, Moses said, well, let's just go to the tent of meetings tomorrow and let God decide who's his leader. And you know the story. The Bible says the glory of God appeared. And when he did, it separated Korah and his followers, and the ground opened up and swallowed him alive in the Sheol. And that began to distinguish Moses as a clear voice for the people. And to some degree, you know, that's a tragic story. You have to wish it would never have happened. But because it did happen, it certainly made the people have a healthy respect for the God that operated through Moses. And we talked about Elijah, where he went to the Mount Carmel showdown, the 400 prophets of Baal and 450 Asherah, prophets of Asherah, and so on. And how he said, if God be God, let's serve him. And he prayed, Lord, answer me, when he poured the water on the sacrifice. Answer me this day, that they may know there's a God in Israel. And Almighty God poured out fire from heaven and consumed the sacrifice and licked up the water. Wow. And Israel repented and turned to God. I bet they did. And God killed, and they killed the prophets of the Asherah, and so on it goes. But, and so in that same line of thinking, I'm not warning anybody to be swallowed up, and I'm not warning anybody. I am asking that God would begin to distinguish his voices, that he would release a grace and a favor to the body of Christ so that we can begin to hear clear, concise, effective, accurate prophetic voices. Because there is a lot of clamor out there, and there will be until the end of the age. It's not going to go away. We need to realize that. There's going to be a lot of voices out there. And we, you know, Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, and another they will not follow. So we need to train ourselves to know his voice and to hear his voice. But he's also going to raise up some people. He's going to raise up some leaders that will have a clear revelation. And we're going to have to begin to identify those people. And it's kind of like what I've said often is find your tribe. Find the ones that are speaking your language of what the Lord is already revealing to you, but they're just giving language, they're giving vocabulary to what you're already perceiving and feeling. And because of that, you know, you feel an attraction, or more than that, you feel a faith to come alive in you when they hear these certain prophetic voices. And Micaiah is another great example. And I'll just very quickly tell you the scenario. This is during the days of Jehoshaphat and Ahab. And the Bible says in 2 Chronicles 18 that Jehoshaphat had joined himself in an alliance with Ahab through marriage. The Bible was clear that Jehoshaphat was a righteous man. He walked with God. God's favor was on his life. Ahab was a rebellious man that married Jezebel, the daughter of a cult priestess, and had brought you know, false worship and counterfeit worship into Israel. And he was a man of great apostasy. And the Bible says here that Jehoshaphat went over and to visit Ahab. What in the world was he doing in Ahab's camp? But he went, and Ahab put on a big party for him, impressed him, sacrificed thousands, bullocks and sheep and lamb, whatever. Just had this big display of honor and respect for Jehoshaphat because he was setting him up. And Jehoshaphat's, you know, kind of touched by all the honor he was given, and Ahab says, you know what, there's a city up here called Ramoth-Gilead. It belongs to us, but it's being occupied by the Arameans. And would you go up with me and let's take that back? That belongs to us. That's our inheritance. And that was true. That part was true, but it wasn't going to come at the hands of Ahab, though, that's for sure, not that apostate king. But Jehoshaphat said, my army is like your army. Let's go. But before we do, let's inquire of the Lord. That was that righteous thread that flowed through Jehoshaphat. Let's just hear what the Lord has to say about it. He said, no problem. I've got 400 prophets. I'll bring them before you. So the Bible tells us here that Jehoshaphat and Ahab sat in the threshing floor, and one prophet after another came. Go up, take it. The city is yours. Go up and take it. The city is yours. Then I want to read this one part because there was one prophet in particular by the name of Zedekiah. It said, and Zedekiah, the son of Shenaniah, made horns of iron for himself and said, thus says the Lord, with these you shall gore the Arameans until they are consumed. And all the prophets were prophesying, saying, go up to Ramoth-Gilead and succeed, for the Lord will give it into the hands of the king. But Jehoshaphat wasn't quite satisfied. He said, isn't there one more? It's kind of interesting. He says, is there not a prophet of the Lord? Now, that's kind of interesting that he would say that, because there were 400 prophets that just came before them that were in Israel, that were functioning under the king of Israel. But he said, is there not a prophet of the Lord? Maybe that king had some discernment. Maybe he realized these prophets were on Ahab's payroll. Maybe he realized they had an agenda and they were incapable of hearing God's voice. Or maybe they were hearing a counterfeit voice. Something about him said, wait a minute, isn't there one more? Isn't there a prophet of the Lord out there somewhere? Ahab said, yeah, there is one, but I hate him. I hate him because he only prophesies evil towards me. Jehoshaphat, oh, let not the king say so. Let's hear what he has to say. So now, all the prophets have prophesied victory. And so a messenger goes to get Micaiah. And the messenger who was sent to summon Micaiah spoke to him, saying, behold, the words of the prophets are uniformly favorable to the king. So please let your word be like one of them and speak favorably. Isn't that just the way it works? Don't tell you what the Lord says. Come and just speak and consist. Say what everybody else is saying. And I love what Micaiah said. As the Lord lives, what my God says, that's all I'll speak. Dear God, give us some more like that. They don't respond to finances. They don't respond to peer pressure. They don't respond to the flow. They said, whatever God says, that's what I'm going to say. And stand on that word. And when he came to the king said, Micaiah, shall we go up to Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall I refrain? He said, oh, go up, succeed, for they'll be given into your hands. He must have said it in a sarcastic way, because Ahab didn't accept it. Go up and take it. You'll succeed. Then the king said to him, how many times must I adjure you to speak to me nothing but the truth in the name of the Lord? So Micaiah said, okay, I saw all of Israel scattered on the mountain like sheep with no shepherd. And the Lord said, they have no master. Let each man return to his house. Then the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, didn't I not tell you? Didn't I tell you that he only prophesies evil to me? And Micaiah said, therefore, hear the word of the Lord. Here's what I'm after. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne and all the host of heaven standing on his right and on his left. And the Lord said, who will entice Ahab, king of Israel, to go up and fall at Ramoth-Gilead? And one said this while another said that. Then a spirit came forward and stood before the Lord and said, I will go and entice him. And the Lord said, how? And he said, I will go and be a deceiving spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. Then he said, you are to entice him and prevail. Go and do so. What an extraordinary passage of Scripture. The time had come. Ahab was coming down. The Lord had had about all of his apostasy that he was going to have. And so, of course, Micaiah is just seeing a vision. Whether that literally happened or not, we don't know. He's seeing a vision. He's being communicated to, where the Lord gave permission to a deceiving spirit to go out, and it was going to fall on anyone whose allegiance wasn't to God. If your allegiance was to a system, if your allegiance was to a man, if it was to a certain belief system, then it opened the door, in this case, for the deceiving spirit to operate in their mouths. But Micaiah said, I'm not responding to any of that. I'm only going to respond to what the Lord says. Now, therefore, it says, behold, the Lord has put a deceiving spirit in the mouth of all your prophets, for the Lord has proclaimed disaster against you. You had 400 prophets stood before the kings prophesying victory. One prophet stood up and said, I saw the whole nation scattered like sheep without a shepherd. Ahab is furious. Ahab is furious. He said, you go take him, put him in prison, give him bread and water, and I'll deal with him when I get back. Micaiah says, if you come back at all, I'm a false prophet. Wow. If you come back at all, God has not spoken to me. And you know the story. They go into the battle and the kings are sitting up, but Ahab had disguised himself so they would not recognize him as king and went down in the battle. And they thought Jehoshaphat was Ahab, so they started coming at Jehoshaphat. The Bible says, and the Lord helped Jehoshaphat escape. Ahab was down, and the Bible says, a guy just shot a random arrow up in the sky, and it comes down and hits Ahab and gives him a fatal blow, and he dies. Just exactly the way the prophetic word went. These are Old Testament tragedies. And we don't want something like that to happen anymore. But what I am asking God for is Micaiah's. That the, if you can put it this way, the spirit of Micaiah, the courage of Micaiah would be released again today, where people would get before God and say, you know what, Lord, I know it might be more popular to prophesy this, or it might be more popular to prophesy that. Just tell me what you're saying, that's what I'll say. And it may not have a lot of fanfare, you know, John the Baptist, you know, you can imagine what he looked like coming out of the wilderness, out of the desert. Been raised in the desert, you know, no telling what his hair may have looked like, his skin, wearing camel skin and, you know, eating locust and honey, and yet he had the word of the Lord and went contrary to the flow, but he had something going on. The Bible said he did no miracles, but he had some anointing because all of Israel came out to hear what he had to say, and he was just, you know, repent, repent. But he was the one to make the crooked places straight and bring down the mountains and bring up the valleys and prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. What an honor. What an honor. And I almost kind of see a similarity, if you will, between John the Baptist and Micaiah. And it was a hard thing to be a prophet back in the Old Testament because you were hated and they put them in prison like Jeremiah was in mud pits and whatever. But my quest here is not to look at all those individual scenarios, but to look at the need we have for a voice to stand up that is clear, concise, only what the Lord says, and then the Lord back it up. What would have happened if he had said all of that and none of it had occurred on the battlefield? Then he would have been labeled a false prophet, could have been stoned. But God backed him up because it was the word of the Lord. Not because Micaiah said it and God backed him up, but because Micaiah saw what God wanted and then prophesied it. And that's where I believe we are today, that there are things in the heavenly realms that we're going to have to begin to see. It says in the book of Hebrews, speaking of Noah, just as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man. We know that the spiritual climate, the spiritual conditions that existed in the days of Noah are a parallel to what we will see today. There are many aspects of that, many applications of that. I believe it has to do with the Nephilim. The spirits of the Nephilim are here today. We're going to deal with them as evil spirits. I believe that. I believe the social issues we deal with today had their origins in Genesis 6. The perversity, the corruptions and murders and all of that has its origin back in Genesis 6. But this is what it says about Noah in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. By faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen. If our conditions are going to be parallel to Noah's, that means unprecedented things are about to happen. Noah was warned about things not yet seen, unprecedented. So we have unprecedented, unforeseen events that are about to occur in our generation that only the spirit of revelation can prepare. Only people with a word from God can prepare us for. By faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household by which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. There are three spirits that are rampant right now, the spirit of Korah, the spirit of Cain, and the spirit of Balaam. I've taught on this before. I did a series called Anointed for Valor and Victory, where I talked about three anointings the Lord is giving us right now to prepare us. And we're going to combat these three spirits. Cain was a religious spirit. He wanted to offer a sacrifice just like Abel. You know, he couldn't question his sincerity. Cain went out, plowed a field, worked the field, labored, sweat, exerted much more effort to bring a sacrifice in as Abel did. He was a tender of the sheep, took his sheep to water, took them over to eat in the grass field. He played his harp, if you will, whatever. But I'm pretty sure most likely one of these little lambs was his buddy. You know, little lamb that always sat up in his lap and one he was particularly fond of. And as he tended these sheep, he loved the little lamb, and the little lamb loved Abel. Cain, on the other hand, was tilling the field, working the field, and the time came for the sacrifice. And so Cain went out and brought the best. Anybody that thinks he didn't bring the best, I believe he was sincere. He wanted to bring a sacrifice to God, but he had a religious spirit. And he went out, and it's representative of the religious mindset. Brings in a sacrifice. And Abel has to bring a sacrifice, and he can't just go find a lame little lamb out there, the one with a lot of blemish. He had to find one with a spot. He had to offer something he loved. So it had to be that one little lamb that he loved that sat in his lap all day. You can just imagine, you can picture, you know, Abel taking the little lamb and laying on the rock, you know. Cain brought his sacrifice of whatever he grew in the field. Abel has a little lamb. And he begins to take a flint rock or whatever he could find and begins to pound away on the neck and the jugular vein because it had to be a sacrifice. And the little lamb trusted Abel. His heart is beating 90 miles per hour, you can imagine. And finally, the flint rock or whatever he used broke through the skin and the jugular vein, and blood began to spew out everywhere, all over the little lamb and all over Abel. And Almighty God came down in a pillar of fire. The Bible says he looked at Abel through the blood of the lamb, and had regard for his sacrifice, and rejected Cain's. Not because Cain wasn't sincere, he was very sincere, but you have to mingle sincerity with truth. You have to mingle sincerity with revelation. That's the thing we've taught about the judgment seat of Christ. You can build with wood, hay, and stubble, or you can build with gold, silver, and precious stone. What Cain did basically is he built with wood, hay, and stubble, and was consumed. He had nothing to show for it. Abel, on the other hand, built according to revelation. He did something according to revelation. As a result of that, his sacrifice was regarded. And so we're there today now. Those two spirits are still working in the church. The spirit of revelation and the spirit of Cain, a religious spirit. And we're going to have to deal with that. And the same remedy for that as it was for Korah and for the spirit of Balaam is revelation, the same thing that Noah had, that we must walk, not just having a group of leaders that have revelation, but every member of the body of Christ must have a spirit of revelation operating and functioning in their life, where they are in constant flow of communication with the Holy Spirit, where they get revelation, they get insight, the Word comes alive, and certainly there's a different mantle, if you will, that comes on leaders to provide leadership, but I love it when I preach something and people come up and say, you know what? You just gave language to what I've been seeing for 2 weeks. Well, that blesses me. That means God's dealing with the people. Maybe I just gave them a framework. Maybe I gave them a vocabulary to articulate what it is they're already seeing. But the reality was God was already speaking. They were getting it by revelation. And so now their revelation and my revelation come together and it ignites faith. It ignites faith. And I believe there is a barometer. The Bible says that in the last days, even the elect would be deceived if it were possible. That means the elect has a little barometer in there, like Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat had a little barometer in there. Isn't there not one more? I can't, something in me, I just can't accept what those, they all sounded good. They're very polished. They're very articulate, but I don't know. Something just doesn't feel right. Isn't there one more? And sure enough, there was one more. And he said, that's the word of the Lord. And he had no business going to that battlefield with Ahab. If it wasn't for the grace of God, he'd have died on that battlefield. But God let him escape because he was righteous in his heart. And so that's where we are right now. We're about to enter a conflict. And there are great deceptions out there. And I'll go so far as to say, I believe a deceiving spirit has been released. And I'm not saying unto God, I'm just saying there's a deceiving spirit out there. The Bible says so. Jesus makes it clear in his admonition to the Laodicean church, which we are. This is clearly the Laodicean age, lukewarm Christianity. And he makes it clear. He said, you think Jesus Christ, the Son of God, speaking about this age, about a church in Laodicea, literally, but also about this age. You think that you're rich and increased in goods and have need of nothing. That means you think you're in one condition, but you're deceived. You're wretched, poor, blind, and naked. And the enemy would like a deceiving voice to keep us naked, to keep us poor and blind and ill-equipped. But a spirit of revelation is coming to wake us up, say, wait a minute. I thought I was clothed, ready for the battle, and I'm naked. And all of a sudden we go to God, we turn to God and say, Lord, clothe me, equip me. I don't want to go to battle like this. And Jesus and the Lord says, then I advise you, I've got counsel for you to buy of me gold refined by fire and white garments to cover the shame of your nakedness and eye salve that you may see. And there you have the seer anointing again. He said, I'm counseling you. I'm giving you advice to be a seer. That's what Jesus said. So he wouldn't advise us to see. He wouldn't advise us to apply eye salve so that our eyes can see by revelation if he wasn't providing that revelation to give us the eye salve. Amen? Logical conclusion. So yes, I believe there are certain prophets and they'll have one level of revelation or experiences, but I believe every one of us can have eye salve applied to our eyes. In fact, I'll go so far as to say we have to. It is mandatory. It is essential that eye salve be applied today and that we begin to listen to that voice. Listen to that voice. I've had some things happen the last few weeks, just little subtle voices that, I mean, I'll give you one example, you know. It seems minor, but 2 weeks ago, the thought dropped in my mind. He said, you know, a couple of months ago, you were supposed to have a dentist appointment, but you had something come up and you had to cancel it. And I said, yeah, that's right. I said, I wish they would call me and set up another appointment. As God is my witness, the next morning, my phone rings and they say, this is your dentist. You missed your appointment a few months ago. Can we reschedule it? I said, how about right now? Just a little subtle voice. It was just a thought that dropped in. And the very next day, a few days after that, the same thing happened again. I thought about a certain guy and he had been on a trip and I just the thought dropped in. I bet he came back with certain things. It didn't matter what it was. And I bet there were four of them. And I mean the next day, get a phone call from the very person and he brought back four things. So just a little, and they were subtle. They were just little, still small voices that just were almost like a thought, almost could I distinguish that from my own thought process. And so it's made me very sensitive here lately. I'm taking some of these things to heart. I'm listening a little carefully and maybe, you know, don't turn right here, go left because, you know, just little things that might keep us out of trouble. But I'm just sensing right now that the Lord is desiring to speak to his people in a new and profound way. And that if he is, that means he's making it available. That's the thing I want to emphasize, that we are going to have voices in our day that are clear, concise, direct, and what they say will happen. That's my prayer. I'll close with this scripture because I believe this is kind of where we are. It says, therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, I will restore you, and before me you shall stand. And if you extract the precious from the worthless, you will become my spokesman. They, for their part, may come to you, but as for you, you cannot go back into them. For I will make you as a fortified wall of bronze. Though they contend with you, they will not prevail over you. For I will be with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. That's where we are, spokesman. If we will stand before the Lord and extract the precious from the worthless, then we become his spokesman. Extract truth from deception. Extract human agendas from the revelation of Jesus Christ. If we return to him, return to the living word, return to God before him, we will stand. And he'll give us the ability to extract the precious from the worthless, the precious from the profane. That's what the sons of Zadok did. The sons of Zadok that were faithful to God in Ezekiel 44 during times of apostasy, and they ministered to the Lord. And as a result of that, it says they came out from that place of ministering to the needs of God, able to discern the clean from the unclean, the precious from the profane. That's where we're going to find His voice, ministering to God, functioning as a priest, ministering to Him. And my prayer life, I don't mean to be too transparent, but my prayer life has changed. I used to have this list of things, and I still have it. I have it, but now I'm just seeking the Lord. I'm just seeking You, Lord. You know, Lord, You know. You know. You know what I need. You know, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. You know, all these things will be added, for Your Father knows what you have need of even before you ask it. And so right now I'm just seeking the Lord. Just, Lord, I need You. You know all my needs. You know the dilemmas I'm in. You know the situations I'm in. But I'm just going to seek the Lord. Return to Me, and before Me you shall stand. And I'll give the ability to extract the precious from the worthless, the precious from the profane. So, Lord, I release that right now to everyone watching, that You would give us this discernment, You would give us this anointing, You would give us this grace to extract the precious from the worthless, to extract the deceptions from the truth in our own minds, in our own hearts, but also as a spokesman for the kingdom of God. Release it through the Holy Spirit. I know there are leaders watching right now, and I feel like some of what I've said tonight has really echoed inside of you, that it's affirming for you some of the things you've already been hearing. And so I just want to confirm that. I just want to release something. If God will give me this grace tonight to release to you an anointing, a courage like Micaiah had, to stand up for the Word of God and not traditions of men and agendas of men, and so on it goes. Just the revelation of Jesus Christ. Let us just be pure-hearted in that. Release that, I pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen, amen. I got time for a couple of questions. You hear a couple that are hot off the press, so I guess these are related to what we've been talking about. This is from John. Do you believe that all overcomers will rule and reign with the Lord during the millennium, or only those martyred, as it suggests? That's a good point. I believe it's all overcomers. That's what I believe. I believe it's the bride of Christ. And I believe every age has the church and the overcomer. Every age, from Ephesus to Laodicea to the present age. And that all the overcomers are part of those that will rule and reign with Him. But it does say in Revelation 20, those that are martyred, beheaded, will rule with Him. But I believe that's in conjunction with. That's my belief. I believe everyone. I believe the bride of Christ is who it is. The bride of Christ rules and reigns with Him as Mrs. Lord Jesus Christ, if we can say it that way. Kind of since you're talking about that, I have another question here that I'll go ahead and kind of answer. But someone asked the question about the seven church ages. So each of the ages have messengers, and they did. Oh, they were asking who the messengers were. But in the first age, I think it would be clear, it would be fair to say, you know, we can't be emphatic because we don't have it in the Bible, but we had a prophet that kind of identified who the predominant voices were. But clearly in the first age, Paul, the Apostle Paul, was the predominant messenger to the Gentile church. In the second age, the one that stood out, that was confirmed by God, that stood with a word, was Irenaeus, or Irenaeus, however you pronounce his name. Then if you come to the third church age, you find that probably the one that stood out to this prophet was St. Martin, for all the same reasons, because of the miracle signs and wonders and the affirmation of the word. The next stage was Columba, the great Celtic prophet that was a messenger to his generation. Of course, Martin Luther followed that, and then John Wesley followed that, and then as many believe that William Branham was a messenger. I believe he was a messenger. I do. To the Laodicean age. And then I have another question that said, if he was the messenger, are there other messengers? I do believe there are more messengers to come. I do. I believe we're the messengers of the covenant. Now, did he function in a certain role? Certainly he did. But are we in need of more messengers? Absolutely we are. There are many things yet to be prophesied and decreed and declared in the days ahead. And so, you know, we relate to God as a son or a bride. But we relate to the Father as a son, but we relate to the church as an apostle or prophet or evangelist or pastor or teacher or as a messenger. And a messenger is simply someone with a message. And I do believe the spirit and power of Elijah is here today to be released in a much more pronounced way to begin to prepare, restore, and turn. That's what it does. Prepare the people, restore the hearts, and restore the people and turn the hearts, which is repentance, to turn. And so I believe that's where we are. I do believe in the seven church ages. I believe the seven churches of Asia Minor. In fact, I'm on the Lord willing to get ahead of myself a little bit. Beginning in January, I'm going to start teaching Revelation 1, 2, and 3. And just to see where it goes, and I'll just take it one session at a time and take each of the seven church ages and the messengers and the admonitions, corrections, and all that goes with that. If the Lord is willing, that's kind of my plan. Pray for us as we come to the end of this year for clear direction of how to move forward in this next year. but anyway, I hope that helps you some, John. But I do believe the all of the bride of Christ rules and reigns with him. And I believe it's from each age, each of the church ages. Someone also asked a question in here. Do I believe that the cloud of witnesses are just the people that die at the end of the age, or are they people that have died throughout church history? Then another question someone asked was, were the cloud of witnesses only Old Testament people? And I believe it is Old Testament and New. I do. And I guess the reason they would come to that conclusion is because you have a listing in Hebrews 11 of many of the Old Testament saints that did exploits for their generation. And then it goes right into Hebrews 12 where it says we're surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. The word witnesses there is testifiers. Martyr is the word, but it's testifiers, a great cloud of testifiers. So they're there to do more than cheer us on. They're there to testify. They have a role to play. They are joined with us. I believe they still carry promises that were made to them that were not fulfilled. I believe that's what Hebrews chapter 11, verses 39 and 40 are all about. That they're waiting for us to inherit the promise so that they're made perfect because the promises have not yet been fully fulfilled. And that promise is of a body of people that walk in union with God, where God is fully inhabited in them and functions through them, doing all the same things through a people that he did when he walked the earth in human form. I believe that's the promise. That's what Enoch saw. That's what Enoch saw all those generations ago, the seventh generation from Adam. He saw a generation of people in whom God was fully integrated and functioned through them so that their words were like his words. But I believe, you know, Bob Jones and John Paul Jackson and these guys are a part of the cloud of witnesses. I believe that. And because they carry something for our generation. They carry promises. They carry words. I remember having a friend say he went had an experience where he saw John G. Lake and, the other missionary, his name escapes me, but they were in heaven praying for South Africa. Both of them had been missionaries to South Africa, and they were still carrying South Africa in heaven. And I have no problem with that because the Bible says the Lord even ever lives to make intercession. So if he's interceding, certainly stands to reason that the cloud of witnesses could be interceding in that realm of the Spirit. I don't have any problem with that at all. But hope that may help. But I believe I don't believe it's everybody. Well, I better not go there. I believe it goes back to this whole issue. I don't know exactly who's in the cloud of witnesses, but I believe you say overcomers. It's what I believe. I wouldn't make an emphatic statement about that, but I believe they, because it says they inherited a promise. They gained approval through their faith. That was what designated them as being a member of the cloud of witnesses. They gained approval through their faith. If a person just barely got into heaven, if a person just barely was living in a justified state, that's a little different category of those that walked in victory on the earth, that carried something on the earth that reflected the revelation of the kingdom, whether it be for a region, whether it been for a church or for a promise or whatever it may have been. So anyway, hope that may help. Can you expound on the biblical expression, the fellowship of his sufferings? Wow. What does it mean? How do you become a part of this fellowship? And what is gained by being in that fellowship? You know, I'll give you a little simple answer that I don't imply would be the totality of that. But I'll tell a little story that the Lord told me one time when I asked the same question. to know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings from Philippians. But one time I had a fishing trip, and I took a friend. We were casual friends, not big buddies or anything, but we were friends. I mean, we knew each other, but weren't really, you know, hanging out buddies. But he liked to fish, I liked to fish. And so one day we went out to fish. He and his son, myself and my brother. And so we were out 33 miles offshore. And a freak storm came up. To this day, they still talk about that storm here in Orange Beach. 1986, I believe it was. And I remember we were having the most beautiful day. The water is as flat as pavement. We were catching tuna, just having an incredible day. And I looked to the north and I saw a big wall of white. And I said, what in the world is that? And we realized it was water that was being picked up off of the surface of the Gulf by wind. And I knew we were in big trouble. And so we went one direction trying to get around it, and there was no getting around it. And to this day, they don't know where the storm came from. It was not predicted. It literally just manifested in the Gulf of Mexico from the north, which cut all the fishermen off. If you were out south of the shore and it came from the north, that means you had to go through the storm to get in. It was called a squall, a freak squall. And I want you to know something. You know, we got in the heart of the storm, and I wasn't sure. I wasn't questioning if we're going to die. I'm wondering which wave is going to kill us. And I meant that. I mean, I literally came to the conclusion we're about to die. Not a philosophical idea. I mean, we were going up waves. My boat was 26 feet long. And the front of my boat was not to the top of the waves, and the back of my boat was not to the bottom. And it would just drop, and we would just crash down, and another one's right behind it. Hour after hour after hour. And I'm driving, I'm fighting these waves, and they're as tall as the side of a building, wind howling, waves breaking in on top of the boat. It was excruciating. And I was pretty sure we were gonna die, literally, no exaggeration. And I just kept fighting, kept fighting, and kept fighting. And this other friend, he was just right there with me, you know. I'm the only one person to drive the boat, but he was doing his part. Nobody freaked out, nobody panicked, we all knew we were in serious trouble. Found out later the Coast Guard went out 26 times to rescue boats that night. 26 times the Coast Guard went out. But we find 5.5 hours later, we finally make it in. What does that have to do with the fellowship of His sufferings? When I asked the Lord about that, he reminded me of that story. Because after that event, that guy that I went fishing with and I had a camaraderie that we didn't have before. We had shared an event that was intense. you know, we were both in the same boat. We were both facing the same crisis. And we both, you know, pretty much had our fears that this was serious. We were in big trouble. And we endured it. And from then till now, we had a different rapport. We connected in a way we didn't connect before. We had an area of fellowship, of sufferings, that brought us to a different realm of relationship that we didn't have before. Another example is my brother died of AIDS. And I probably never said that publicly, but he died of AIDS. I don't believe he was a homosexual. He supposedly got it from a woman. However he got it, in 1995 he died. But we went through a year and a half of in the hospital and out, just constantly sick, almost died several times. And in the process of that, you come in contact with other people that are facing life-threatening diseases. One guy in particular, I remember, that was facing cancer at the same time. And so because we were facing this life-threatening disease with my brother, and they were facing cancer with their son, and we had a fellowship that we didn't have before. The families didn't know each other very well at all, but after we had this common ground of both fighting for our loved ones' lives, this fellowship of sufferings, it brought a camaraderie that we didn't have before. And it brought one that nobody could understand unless they had been through that themselves. Nobody can really appreciate that dilemma, that emotion, unless you face it yourself. You know, unless you've gone through it, and now even if I meet people that are dealing with terminal illness, I have a place of understanding with them a fellowship in their sufferings that I would not have had I not gone through that. So I believe we go through shared events with the Lord. Whether we like it or not, we're going to go through crises. We're going to go through deserts. We're going to go through wildernesses. I wish it were all a bed of roses, but if you're contending for God right now, if you're fighting for the revelation of the kingdom on the earth, most likely you've been through some things. And I know pastors all over the country that have talked about things they faced, and, you know, pastors probably have a fellowship of suffering that if you're not a pastor, you can't appreciate it. But I believe with the Lord, we go through certain crises, and that it brings a realm of understanding that if you didn't have that fellowship, if you didn't have that fellowship of sufferings, you wouldn't share that camaraderie. You wouldn't share that heart, that same perspective. That you have to experience it to some degree to value what that person has been through. And so that's kind of what I believe it means. You can apply that however. But that's at least the way the Lord has taught me what it means to be the fellowship of His sufferings. That we're going to be persecuted, but He was persecuted. We have a place of fellowship with Him. We have a place of understanding. It opens a door with the Lord to connect with Him in a way that we could never have connected had we not shared that experience. Amen. I think that's the best way I can say it. Well, we'll close with that. That was a great question. Lord, I thank You for every person that's watched tonight. I pray that You bless them. Bless them richly. Lord Jesus, as we come to the end of this year, give us insight with understanding. Give us clarity. Give us direction. We pray for these prayer requests. Everyone that's sick, everyone with financial crisis, everyone with family issues, we lift them up to You right now. Not only these on this paper, but also there. Everyone watching, if you are facing a crisis, I ask, Lord, that You inject Yourself, that You would intervene in their crisis, that You would inject Yourself into their need, whether it be sickness, for healing of their bodies, whether it be for revelation of their destiny, whether it be family issues and prodigal sons and daughters or whatever it may be. We're asking You, Lord, to take notice of it and hear the cries of our heart as You prepare us and equip us to represent Your kingdom in this last day generation. Grant that, Lord, I ask You in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.